subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. The hopes of a permanent cure to the pandemic that has claimed over a million lives worldwide have received a fresh energy with the change in the calendar year. While many countries have already authorized the emergency use of vaccination, others are all set to roll out different vaccine candidates in coming days. The largest South Asian and second most hit country, India, is taking cautious steps. While vaccine facilities believe that government could give them permission anytime, New Delhi says it wants to ensure safety before it takes any decision.
Different Indian states held a dry run for the COVID-19 vaccination, a move aimed at computing the time and logistics vaccination drive will require once a vaccine is rolled out. The dry run process included the possible adverse scenarios during and after administering the vaccine. Feasibility of Covin, a software which analyzes priority group and beneficiaries for the vaccination drive, was also checked.
So we want to ensure ke jo bhi hamara vaccine jab lage to hum pure se taiyar ho. तो इसी वजह से ये ड्राई रन हो रहा है तो उसमें लॉजिस्टिक्स से लेकर जो हमारा कोविन सॉफ्टवेयर है उससे लेकर जो फील्ड लेवल में ऑपरेशन इश्यूज हैं तो ये ड्राई रन का एक ही मतलब है कि ऑपरेशंस में हमें कहाँ दिक्कत आ रही है तो जिसे हम अभी रेक्टिफाई कर ले कि जब एक्चुअल वैक्सीन हमें डालना इंट्रोड्यूस करना पड़े तो उसके लिए कोई दिक्कत ना हो.
India aims to deliver 600 million coronavirus shots in the next 6 to 8 months, starting in January, with emergency use approval for the AstraZeneca vaccine expected within days. The country's drug regulator is also considering similar approvals for the Pfizer vaccine and another developed by India's Bharat Biotech. Chairman of the Serum Institute of India has exuded confidence in the vaccine his facility is developing.
You'll be hearing some good news from the UK very soon. You've heard that from the CEO of AstraZeneca. It's a 90 to 95% effective vaccine. If we just keep a 2 to 3 month gap between dose one and dose two, they will make that very public with documentation. So we'll wait for that. In the meanwhile, the emergency use licensure should come by the end of December or early January in the UK. And, you know, simultaneously then we hope to get that in India as well.
Meanwhile, India, after Europe and few other Asian countries, has also reported the mutated strains of the coronavirus, which is spreading rapidly in the United Kingdom. The highest medical authority, however, has reassured citizens of the country that the vaccine will be effective in that case as well. The sustained and integrated efforts of the government and people are already paying off as the country has successfully flattened the curve in the past few weeks. From a peak in mid-September, where around 1 lakh cases were being registered every day, the count has come down to 20,000. To fight the COVID, the spirited people are not depending on the vaccine alone. A number of them have brought radical changes to their lifestyle too.
Minorities are under assault in Pakistan. Their freedom is curtailed and rights snatched. Despite international community repeatedly calling out the rising religious fundamentalism in the country, the number of crimes against minorities has risen sharply. Recently, a mob led by Islamic fanatics demolished a Hindu temple in Kark region of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province. They shouted religious slogans and said Pakistan had no place for infidels, a term used for non-Muslims. Rights activists have condemned the decision, saying Imran Khan's new Pakistan has nothing new and in fact the situation has worsened under his tenure.
A radicalized Islamic mob led by local clerics demolished a Hindu temple, an act that further deepens the religious fault lines in the country. In what could be described as a planned attack, a rally was organized by Jamiat Ulema-e-Islami Fazl, a Sunni Deobandi political party in Pakistan, where speakers delivered fiery speeches, after which the charged crowd stormed the temple, set it ablaze and razed it to the ground. The video clip that has gone viral shows the anger people have been infused with by the religious hardliners who are gaining prominence in country's mainstream.
ये 101 साल पुराना मंदिर था और ये पाकिस्तान में हिंदू किसी तरह भी महफूज नहीं है, ना वो इबादत कर सकते हैं ना वो मंदिर में जा सकते हैं। दिन ब दिन मंदिरों की तोड़ फोड़ और घिराव जलाओ का सिलसिला तेज होता जा रहा है, खास तौर पर इमरान खान की हुकूमत जैसे जैसे कमजोर हो रही है और पाकिस्तानी फौज के खिलाफ जो अवाम में नफरत है, खास तौर पर खैबर पख्तूनख्वा के लोगों में जो नफरत है, वो जैसे जैसे दिन ब दिन जोर पकड़ रही है। तो ये टारगेट कर रहे हैं माइनॉरिटीज को और सिंध के बाद अब ये खैबर पख्तूनख्वा में ये जो वाकया हुआ है, ये अब यानी के पाकिस्तान के नॉर्थ से लेके साउथ तक कहीं पे भी कोई हिंदू जो है वो सेफ नहीं है।
Now protests have erupted in Pakistan where the community is demanding urgent justice. They want their temple to be restored to original shape and an expedited punishment for the perpetrators. Hindu representatives have sought intervention of the Supreme Court of Pakistan, which has now asked for a comprehensive report by January 4.
सुप्रीम कोर्ट इसका सोमोटो ले और जो शरपसंद है उनको सिर्फ गिरफ्तार ना किया जाए बल्कि 295A और 295B और C के तहत उन पर मुकदमात कायम किए जाएं, क्योंकि मजहबी अकलियतों की कोई भी जगह को मुस्मार करना वो 295A में आता है।
Observers say that it wasn't an isolated incident of some hooliganism but a part of the systematic drive launched against the minorities in the state. Minorities were a considerable size in Pakistan's population in 1947 but have now reduced to a limited few owing to constant state-backed atrocities. Whether it is a Hindu, Christian or Sikh, everybody has become a victim of state-backed persecution of minorities. Forced conversions and marriages have become a common phenomenon in the region. Pakistan has been called out for its apathy towards minorities at various global platforms, but the authorities have not cared to address the issue. The United States has called it a country of particular concern for having engaged in systematic, ongoing, egregious violations of religious freedom. UN says that minorities are under threat in Pakistan. The successive governments in Pakistan have made tall claims of working in the welfare of minorities. But the vandalism of minority prayer sites blatant misuse of blasphemy laws against them, and legislations being framed every day to further marginalize them reek of a completely opposite and inhumane situation for minorities.
Moving on, the political crisis in Nepal is not appearing to be dying down. In fact, it has deepened with sweeping protests across the capital and other parts of the country demanding the rollback of the dissolution of the lower house of the parliament. Meanwhile, the country's neighbor China, which has been accused in the past of being intrusive, is reaching out to the communist leaders of Nepal. The self-assumed mediator is reportedly trying to bring all stakeholders on negotiating table to prevent chaos and instability. But can China be trusted? There are many who believe that Beijing has ulterior motives and will never help Nepal without its strategic and trade interests.
Tens of thousands of Nepalese who have been opposing Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli's haste move to dissolve parliament took to the streets of Kathmandu demanding a withdrawal of the move. They termed the move immoral and unconstitutional. Oli had prematurely dissolved the parliament despite having a majority in the house. Protesters say the constitution of Nepal that was promulgated in 2015 doesn't allow such exercise. The government must complete its 5 years. They also said that such decisions would not only set a wrong precedent, but would also hamper the political stability of the Himalayan country.
प्रधानमन्त्री दुई जना एकलले चाहिँ यो जुन संसद विघटन गरेकोमा नेपाली जनता आक्रोशित पनि छन् र यो पाँच वर्षको म्यान्डेट दिएका नेपाली जनताले र पाँच वर्षको म्यान्डेटमा गर्दछ संविधान विपरीत यो विघटन गरेकोमा आम नेपाली जनता यसको विरुद्धमा छ.
Oli had taken the calculative move to prevent his ouster from the government, where he was witnessing an increasing opposition within his own party, as many of the cabinet members had joined the Dahal faction to present a no-confidence motion against him. Oli has thus far defended his decision, saying the internal squabbling and a lack of cooperation from his party has paralyzed decision-making, forcing him to seek a fresh popular mandate. Meanwhile, Beijing, which has self-assumed the role of a mentor in Nepal politics, dispatched a four-member team to Kathmandu. Led by Guo Jiazhu, a vice minister of the International Department of the Chinese Communist Party, who had played a key role in the merger of the communist parties in Nepal post-2017 elections, the delegation met almost all major stakeholders behind closed doors. Beijing says it was a regular meeting that focused on international affairs and not Nepal's politics.
中联部的有关团组于近日访问了尼泊尔，广泛会见尼朝野主要政党领导人，就中尼党籍交往、与互学互鉴、推动“一带一路”框架内各领域务实合作等双方共同关心的议题交换意见。
The statement, however, has been termed farcical by observers across the political spectrum. They say China has been trying to take virtual control of Kathmandu. Nepalese youth, which has held several anti-China demonstrations in past, staged a protest against Beijing, urging it to not interfere in the domestic politics of the country. While some of the international commentators already believe that China has been guiding Kathmandu in many of its decisions, some have even raised the possibility of a Chinese hand in Nepal's recent crisis. And they advise, if this is even partially factual, then now is the time when Nepalese, cutting across the political ideologies, must come together to drive out their real opposition.
The illegally occupied region of POK is grappling with inflation. The cost of almost all items has soared. The wheat flour price has especially skyrocketed, with people not being able to purchase enough flour even for a square meal a day. People are struggling to fulfill their basic needs with the income they earn through their menial jobs. Locals say with the coming of Imran Khan's PTI in the region, their life has only changed for worse.
Thousands of residents in Tarar Khel region of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir took to streets against an unprecedented surge in food inflation, especially the prices of wheat flour that have skyrocketed in the past few months. They termed it double whammy amid the pandemic that has already hit the economy and the employment. They also accused Islamabad of being discriminatory towards them, as the people of the region are being charged up to 60% more than what people in Pakistan pay. They urge the government to open borders with India, where they say the quality of flour is good and rates reasonable.
पाकिस्तान के अंदर दिल्ली के अंदर 1650 रुपए पे बिकता है और वही आटे का थैला यहाँ 2100-2200 और जगह पर 2500 और 2700 का बिकता है और हम ये कहते हैं कि अगर आप हमें ये आटा पुराने रेट पे प्रोवाइड नहीं कर सकते तो फिर हमारी बॉर्डर खोल दीजिए, हम इंडिया से आटा खरीदेंगे तो 50% डिस्काउंट पे हमें वो आटा मिला सर होगा। तमाम चीजें ये इंडिया से लेते हैं और उसे के ऊपर डबल कीमत लगा के दिया, हमें फरोख्त करते हैं।
People in the illegally occupied POK and Gilgit-Baltistan are repeatedly subjected to discriminations, where they are made to pay a significantly more amount for almost all goods and services, despite a consistently plummeting per capita income. Locals say a consistent hike in the prices has deeply affected their lifestyle, with poverty staring at a large section of the population.
आटा में असर नहीं, आटे का किसी को नवाला तक में असर नहीं, दो वक्त की रोटी खाने वाला एक वक्त पे आ गया है।
और गैस महंगी,
हाय हाय,
और अंडे महंगे,
हाय हाय,
मछली महंगी,
हाय हाय,
और मुर्गी महंगी,
हाय।
The administration, however, has not shown any empathy with the plight of the people. It has, in fact, cracked down on those leading the anti-government demonstrations. But the locals say that they are not fazed by this brutality and will continue to protest against the immoral pricing of even staple food.
India boasts of different kinds of classical and folk dance forms. Dance revitalizes the mind and soul, and watching a performance in the backdrop of artistically carved and magnificently lit temples and monuments is a surreal experience. Today we take you to a similar setting of the International Odissi Dance Festival, which mesmerized the audiences.
Donned in traditional outfits, classical dancers from around the country participated in a 5-day-long International Odissi Dance Festival to showcase their talent. The festival promoted the rich culture of India's Odisha state. Each year, this international festival is organized by the government of Odisha with the help of Guru Kelu Charan Mohapatra Odissi Research Center in Bhubaneswar. Dancers from Indian states like Gujarat, Bangalore, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra took part and left the audience awestruck with their performance. Due to ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, international artists were not able to make it to the festival this year.
We are really feeling proud And also, I'm quite delighted that I was able to perform an international festival at this age.
The festival gives an opportunity to local artists to showcase their talent and show their expertise in the field of art, music, dance and theatre. It helps dancers to get trained under different gurus from different parts of the globe, besides getting to interact, improvise and learn from each other. But this year, Odissi dancers were practicing virtually to prevent the spread of the coronavirus.
This International Odissi Dance Festival is the annual feature of Odissi Research Center. Now, more than one decade, almost 14 years, we have been doing this. But the date is always fixed from 26th to 30th of December. And here, if you calculate all the 5 days, so you will find more than 500 artists, dancers and musicians calculating all. And they represent from all over the world, international artists. And this is the platform we give to the budding artist and to the established, the middle group and the celebrities.
The 5-day event is a confluence of Odissi art and culture aimed at celebrating the love for the age-old traditional classical dance form. Even it gave a good opportunity for budding artists.
We are actually feeling very happy because at this corona time it has been organized for us, and we are the dancers, we are not getting any platform, and in this corona time it has actually organized, so we are very happy and lucky to perform here. And last year we used to dance at Rabindra Mandap, which was actually organized in a very large, from internationally dancers also used to come, but this time only Indian dancers are coming here and performing. But we are also happy since this is organized here.
Such festival represent the rich culture and traditional heritage of Odisha and preserve it for coming generations.
The country organizes hundreds of dance festivals every year. Now, I leave you with some images of people from across the world welcoming 2021 with wide range of celebrations. Goodbye and take care.